Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the seventh meeting of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee in 2023. Before we begin, can I remind those members using electronic devices to please switch them to silent. Our first item of business this morning is the pre-legislative scrutiny of Scotland's future agricultural policy. Our evidence session today is with members of the Agriculture Reform Implementation Oversight Board, the AREOB, and its Agricultural Policy Development Group. And a welcome to the meeting Martin Kennedy, Tim Bailey, Anne-Rae MacDonald and Kate Rowell, who are members of AREOB, and Vicky Swales, who is a member of the Agricultural Policy Development Group. We've approximately 90 minutes this morning for question discussion. We'll finish approximately 10:30. So I'm going to kick off this morning and ask you to consider what the core purpose of AREOB is and how it's supporting policy reform, and give us an indication of the board's current work programme. So we'll kick off with Martin.
Thank you very much. Well, obviously the core programme for the AREOB is about agricultural policy in the future and how we're going to support the industry. In terms of the progress, I would suggest that the progress is probably slow right now, but to my own mind, and I'm sure others would agree, it's going in the right direction. The purpose is extremely important right now because in terms of future agricultural support, bearing in mind this is an agricultural bill, the agricultural support is going to be vital to maintaining, our ability to produce high quality food. Secondly, to address emissions reduction, and thirdly, to address enhancement of biodiversity, which has been accepted. There's been a loss to a certain degree of biodiversity, but in terms of the ability to address all these three of food, climate and biodiversity, that is what the main driver of the AREOB is. And as I said, progress is probably slow. I would accept that progress is slow in that, and we could have been started on this. And I've said on many occasions that, you know, maybe we need to let the industry lead this, because this is agricultural support that's 100% necessary to continue to allow us to produce high quality food that we're used to. From a Scottish perspective, we're probably in the best place, and we would say this obviously being to a degree, because the climate, the maritime climate we have a fantastic ability to produce high quality food sustainably. We've been doing it for a long time. Sometimes we feel we don't get the recognition for that, but in terms of the AREOB's progress, it is slow, but to my mind it's going in the right direction. But we need to make sure we're at a crossroads right now, we're at a crossroads now. If we get this right, we could probably showcase Scotland right across the world and how we actually deliver food and address climate emissions and address biodiversity.
Kate.
Yeah, I don't suppose I need to tell anybody here how important agriculture is to the economy in Scotland, not just the rural economy, the whole economy in Scotland. And it touches every single part of Scotland, every single local authority, every single constituency. It's the absolute bedrock of our whole economy. That's obviously why it's so important to get future support right. We need to get it right and not get it right quickly, but we need to get it right. And as Martin says, progress has definitely been slower than we would like on AREOB. It's been slower than I think industry would be asking for as well. But it is heading in the right direction. I think it's so important that we get buy-in from the farming sector. That's a really important part of future plans. And this co-design, co-development is showing that government and industry can work together to push this forward. So I think it's overall a positive direction that we're moving in, but as Martin says, slower than most of us would like to go. We'd like to be starting to do all the good things that we know we can do much quicker.
Tim, just the same question to you, but why is it so slow? We've known that we were going to need something to replace CAP since 2016, and the climate crisis, biodiversity crisis, nothing new. So why has there been so slow progress?
I think, I suppose first and foremost, I suppose it's important to state the obvious at the end of the day when collectively we're designing a kind of made in Scotland agricultural policy, then that's a hell of a change from where we've been. You know, we've had during our 50 years of a common agricultural policy where the rules, the boundaries and everything else have been fairly clearly set, where our opportunities to do something for the good of our sector have been, you know, we tweak at the edges. So the fact that, you know, you can rip that up and start again has been... I think, you know, from my own point of view, I suppose it's been a little bit frustrating that we should have taken a bit more of a strategic approach from it because it is so complex. And I think that will have accounted for some of the delay we've seen because there's been a bit of an element of, you know, how do we start and what do we move on first, et cetera. But I would certainly support what Martin and Kate have said that, you know, we're starting to get there. And I think the key point is, I suppose the key benefit of an Ariob process is the fact that if we have a Made in Scotland policy to tackle the climate emergency, to restore more nature and to maintain productive food systems, then we can only do that in consultation with the industry, who ultimately be the ones who have to implement it, have to adopt it. And, you know, we'd be even further behind if the industry hadn't been involved in that process.
Anne and then Vicky.
Yes, there obviously has taken longer than ideally we would have liked, although we started off, I think, when we first met, we were still dealing with the repercussions of COVID. So there was limitations in terms of what we could do in terms of having face-to-face meetings, etc., which are always far more productive. Looking at our work, we're obviously looking to build upon the work that was done by the farmer-led groups. They, to a certain extent, were a rather different beast to the area. We've got a wide range of interests within the area group. And also the farmer-led groups were, it was very focused. There was kind of 3 months in which to go and write a report. This is the process with Ariob is kind of very much Scottish Government led. And the Ariob is an advisory group. It is not a decision-making group, and that's quite a fundamental issue. And looking across, as others have said, in terms of what we're dealing with, we're not just looking at it through a carbon lens, because agriculture is so much more than that. It's multifaceted, as Kate has already said. It plays an integral part right across so many portfolios, economy, tourism, food supply, etc. And there's such, well, as so many of you here know, the diversity within agriculture in terms of farm size, farm intensity, land tenure, accessibility to markets, etc. There's a huge amount to be considered.
You commented that this was really government-led, and also the disappointing delay. We did hear from the farmer-led groups last week, and Andrew Moore said the arable sector is in grave danger of leaving the Scottish Government way behind. We are at the top of the cup compared to the Scottish Government, which is down at the bottom. We're leaving the Scottish Government behind on things that we are doing. Do you play any part in that? Are you holding the government to account? I know the government, you co-chair it, but are you raising these concerns that the farmers are actually appear to be leading the way rather than the government, and potentially that's going to have an impact on the policies you develop? I'll stay with Anne with that, then I'll move to Vicky.
Yes, the timescales of this are regularly raised, and obviously it's key to obviously fulfilling the commitment that's been given by the government for a just transition, because we have a sort of fixed target at the end. So it's critical, given the life cycles of nature that we're dealing with, that it can take some considerable time for changes to be made in agriculture and therefore for outcomes to be delivered. At the same time, as Martin alluded to there, this is something that we need to get right. We've seen elsewhere the perils of rushing into policy.
Hey, Vicky.
Thanks, Convener. I'll answer that last point and then come to purpose and timescales. I mean, I think some farmers are leading the way I think the problem is that the majority of farmers are not in that position necessarily. If they were, then we would have seen faster reductions in greenhouse gas emissions. We wouldn't be seeing some of the biodiversity impacts or some of the problems within the sector. So the question is, how do we get all farmers to be in the same place that some of the farmers who are in the farm-led groups are? And that is a big challenge. In terms of the purpose of AREOB, I think members of the farming community and our organisation or others are in a really privileged position to have a seat at the table to co-design future policy. As others have said, it's about replacing the common agricultural policy, which we've been part of for more than 50 years, so that's no insignificant undertaking to do. And it's also about ensuring that that policy determines how more than £500 million of taxpayers' money will be spent each year supporting the farming sector. And that's a really important question as well. So I think we all take that role very seriously. I think we also need to look at agriculture in the wider context of land use more broadly in Scotland, which has a big role to play in tackling the twin challenge of nature crisis and climate emergency, and ensuring we produce food and timber and all those other goods and services. In terms of the timescales, yes, we've mentioned we've had farm-led groups. We've been through a process since 2016, since the referendum. There's been a long history here. One of the decisions the government took early on was about stability and simplicity. This Parliament passed the previous Agriculture Act, which essentially committed to retaining EU schemes through to 2024. We then had a group which preceded the farmer-led groups, which was the Farming and Food Production Future Policy Group, then the FLGs, then we had COVID, and in that time we've had parliamentary elections and a change in minister. So not surprisingly, there's been a lag, but we would be the first to say we are not where we need to be. The clock is ticking and we need to get on quickly in developing this policy and implementing it.
Do you think that the government's in danger of losing any kind of control of farming, where you see the early adopters or whatever actually taking all the action that they think they need, so reducing inputs, looking at methane, carbon, whilst they wait for policy to be developed?
I don't think necessarily. I mean, clearly some farmers are leading the way. Some of those farmers may be less dependent on some of the support and some of the subsidies that I've just referred to. I would argue not all of them are leading the way. I think many farmers have got the message on climate and are taking strong action. I think where we're behind where we need to be on the biodiversity front, I don't think sufficient numbers of farmers are taking as much action as they could. And that's not to say that some farmers aren't doing amazing work for some of our important habitats and species in Scotland, but we have a really big job to do. And so I don't think it's that is moving away from where policy needs to be. The two need to work together. The industry can help lead and show the way in some cases.
Thank you. Jim Fairley.
Excuse me. Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning, panel. The board's remit is to support policy reform, cut emissions across agriculture, support production of sustainable, high-quality food, address the twin crisis of climate and nature loss of biodiversity. Some of the highlights from some of your previous meetings, you're looking at shaping conditionality, data collection, standardisation and baselining, capacity of advisory services, payment methodologies for future agricultural support. And you are doing all of that at a timescale where you think it's too slow. Have you got too much on your plate?
Can I just remind the panel members, your mics will be operated automatically, so you don't need to touch. Thanks. Martin?
Martin, yeah. That's the rotor. Right, that's right. Sorry, it was the eye contact, Martin.
No, fine. Right, no bother. Too much on our plate. Farmers and crofters have always got too much on their plate, but the fact they're trying to put everything else on other people's plates sometimes gets missing. And I think we've got to remember that. This is about agriculture and food production. We'll have to take that. This has to be at the core. It's the core principle of what we do. And if we don't, we'll take it. We've taken it for granted for far too long. So, I mean, farmers and crofters are extremely resilient. Always have been, always will be. But in terms of too much on our plate, no. I don't think AREOB has got too much on its plate, because we've got to address all these issues. And that's why it's a co-design. So all these issues must be addressed, but at its core must be continuation of food food production, because it's not just about agriculture. This is not just about investment. I've never liked the term subsidy. This is about investing in the business of agriculture that gets a huge return off the back of it. So in terms of how we can deliver, as farmers and crofters are key, because we're managing excess of 70% of the land in Scotland, we can deliver that. So we need to have that on our plate, because if we don't have that all, then we tend to fall back into the situation where we're looking at things in silos. We cannot do that. We can't look at things in silos. We need to look at food, climate and biodiversity all in the same globe, basically. And by doing that, we can take everybody's interests at heart and look at it. Because if we look at one thing simply, whether it's carbon footprint or whether it's biodiversity or gains from... I mean, and one very, very quick example... We're very, sort of topography of our farm is 800 feet, 2,500 feet. We've got continental cattle, continental sheep on the low ground, very extensive in the high ground. So in the high ground, the carbon footprint is very poor, but the reality is the biodiversity benefits that brings is very, very high. On the low ground, the output is great, the carbon footprint's good, but in terms of biodiversity benefits, it's not so good. So we can't afford to simply single out a sector and look at it in its own right. We have to look at it. We cannot afford to look at it in silos. In terms of that investment, and again, coming back to the comment and subsidies, which I really hate the term, it's about an investment and the return, because this is about, if we don't get this right, it's the infrastructure that's built on the back of agriculture that's at stake here. It's the markets, it's the abattoirs, it's the processors, it's the packers that are now beginning to get really concerned about the output of Scottish agriculture. If it depletes any further, then the impact that can have on critical mass that keeps them viable is going to be unsustainable for them.
Can I just... I'm going to come back to you, Vicky. I'm going to ask the whole board, given the explanation that Martin has just given. We've got a wide range of stakeholders within the AREOB. Is there general consensus about where you are right now and how you're going to go forward? I'll come to you with that, Vicky.
I think in broad terms and at high level, I think all AREOB members, I would suggest, share the understanding and the aspiration of where we need to get to and is behind the Scottish Government's vision that it's set out. Of course, the devil's always in the detail, isn't it? So when you get down and drill down into different policy choices, different kinds of payments, different emphases on things, then there will be differing views with the stakeholders around the table. But I think Martin's absolutely right that the broad thrust of what we need to do, understanding that agriculture is multifunctional, its primary function is to produce food, but you can't produce food without a healthy natural environment, without a stable climate in which to operate. All these things come together, and we need to think about our economy as part of that. You know, you can't separate out these issues. Martin's absolutely right. But no, there will be differences of opinion on different elements of policy, and that's good and healthy, and we debate robustly those things, and we will come to different views. But at the end of the day, government will have to make a decision as to what choices it is going to make in terms of that policy framework and exactly how it deploys that, as I say, more than £500 million of public money.
Policy differences, are those detailed differences, are they causing part of the delay?
I don't think that's where the delay is coming from, no. I think it's many of the other things we've talked about there in terms of the process. We have to acknowledge, and the Scottish Government has been very clear in setting this out to AREOB, the process which has to be gone through. So we need to produce an Agriculture Act which creates the powers which can then enact that policy. At the moment, we are operating under the existing legislation and the existing schemes which were carried over from the Common Agricultural Policy. So this Parliament has to do its work. That bill has to be in place. There has to be secondary legislation. There has to be policy development. So inevitably, we are unfortunately looking at those timelines through to 2027, 2028, before we actually see implementation of this policy. The problem probably is that we should have started sooner, but, you know, it's like the old Irish adage of, I want to get there, well, I wouldn't start from here. You know, we are where we are. So we just need to press on as quickly as we can. And I would say take every opportunity within the existing legislation
and the existing opportunities, we can make some changes in the next couple of years. We don't necessarily need to wait for the new legislation to make some changes. So I'm thinking there about things like capping of current payments, of how we deploy the existing budget, of making more conditional, and that's going to have conditionality on payments that can happen in 2025. So there are some shorter term options for things we can do.
Just through the chair. Tim, please.
To be fair, it's a good follow-on from what Vicky said and what you were asking, really, Jim, around whether difference of opinions were delaying decisions. And I would agree. I think broadly we're all in the right place. There's no, everyone signs up to the fact, you know, agriculture's got to meet its climate, undertake its climate duties, its climate responsibilities, similarly around nature, and similarly with that within a realm of producing food for our nation. I think where it's come round to is around process, and I suppose my plea through Ariob all along has been a case of, you know, we need more urgency, we need more ambition, and come back to Vicky's point, is utilising existing tools to help that happen, because, you know, my poor colleagues here have heard me endlessly talk about the runway. You know, we've got a runway to 2032 to enable our sector to fulfil its target to hit 31% reduction by 2032. We're now in 2023. And as we were chatting earlier, you know, if we want to breed low methane cattle, for example, and a heifer gets conceived now, then it won't be delivering any low methane beef for at least another 5 years. That takes us to 2028. So we need to be doing stuff now in the interim. So we need more ambition around the interim programmes. Soil testing, carbon footprint audits, animal health and welfare plans are a good start. But we need far, 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 far more than that if agriculture's got any hope of getting anywhere near the target in 2032. And there are things we can do within Ariob around that. And a lot of that is around processes. Is don't just sequence things in serials. We need to be doing a lot more stuff in parallel.
OK. I'm hearing that there's general agreement across the board at a high level and everybody agrees to the principles in general. But where are the disagreements in real terms? Where are the details that are causing the difficulty so that this process gets done smoothly? Martin. Yes.
So, obviously, I said right at the start, we're probably at a crossroads now. And in terms of where the budget split's going to be, and as Vicky's highlighted, you know, there's over £500 million worth of money coming into agriculture right now, which I think still in real terms is relatively cheap, given the fact that, you know, 2020-2021 public spending in Scotland was £99 billion, which means for every pound we're spending in public spending, we're only spending half of one penny on public security and on food security. And I think, well, jings, that's not very much to pay considering what's at risk here if we don't get it right. So in terms of that difference of opinion, obviously, when I say we're at the crossroads, where we see in the sort of four-tier structure that we're looking at, tier one, sort of the base payments that's getting, we're looking at, we're all in agreement with the sort of tiered structure approach. Tier two, where you're looking at the enhanced payments, then you have tier three and tier four above that. Obviously, where the tensions will come is from an agricultural perspective, we feel that it's absolutely imperative from an agricultural perspective, that the bulk of the existing split of that budget should be within tier one and tier two. And you would include things like voluntary coupled support, and less favoured area support within that as well, because that is deemed still as a direct payment. Less favoured area support scheme is a pillar two payment currently, but speaking to farmers, and 85%, so this is about 85% of the land in Scotland are in that LFA area, and they deep see that as a direct support. So that's where tensions will come, because, you know, others, and not, I can fully understandably see that we should be putting far more into the environment, more into climate, more into emissions. But let's not forget, if we don't get this right, if we don't support the primary production element within Scotland, we're at risk of exporting our emissions, and indeed exporting, you know, we're here to do our bit for the country, but we're not here to try and solve global emissions. And let's not forget that if we don't do it here, we could be importing products from other parts of the world that don't have the same care and attention for animal welfare, and certainly don't have the same care and attention for the environment as well. So we need to be careful. That's where the tensions, one of the key tensions, will probably happen, Jim.
Kate, yes.
Yes, going back to your very first question, Jim, I think we've seen in the past where focusing too narrowly on one thing gets us. And I mean, historically, payments have been focused on producing more and more and more and more without looking at anything else. And that's why we are where we are. So I think it's vital that Areob and policymakers in general look right across the board at all these different things you're talking about. And that means, it means short term, as Vicky's been saying, there's maybe more we can do in the short term to change things to get on that journey. But as Tim has very eloquently said, this is a long-term game. You know, 5 years is not very much in farming time, really, when you start to think about the changes you want to make. So I think we need, you know, the sort of things that we've been talking about, and I think, again, we're in broad agreement on this, is that farms are not, it's not one size fits all for policy. We need to absolutely consider every single sector. What fits in Lewis is not going to fit in East Lothian. We need to make sure that we look at farms on a case-by-case basis so that they can all play to their strengths and do whatever they can do to hit all these different targets. And we need to make sure that we don't end up with unintended consequences if we do go down one route and not the other. So all those things are things that are being discussed at Areob. But I think it was Anne made the very key point that we are an oversight advisory board. It's not us that are actually making the decisions. All we can do is input into that board and try to make sure that Scottish Government make the decisions that are best for everybody.
Okay. Yeah, Vicky, I've got a quick start for you. It seems to me there's where some of the real tension is coming from. Farmers want to produce food, they want to do it sustainably, but other parts of the Areob want to look after biodiversity and climate change. Where do you sit in that?
Well, I don't think it's quite as polarised as you present it, Jim, to be honest. I mean, I think it's not an either-or, it's an and. We have to do both these things. We have to produce food, but we have to do it sustainably. Well, there are always trade-offs and there are decisions to be made. And so to come to your specific question about when we get into the policy and where the differences are, Martin is absolutely right and he's alluded to those. It's about how the budget is then deployed across the 4 tiers of the framework that the Scottish Government has set out and what level of what you put in each of those tiers. And particularly in Tier 2, which a lot of weight has been put on that, particularly by the Scottish Government, saying that's the engine room of its delivery, that's where the enhanced conditionality is going to come. So currently about two-thirds of the budget is spent on direct payments, which map onto those Tier 1, Tier 2. We would argue that if you're going to have any chance of meeting your nature and climate targets as part of that, you're going to have to look really seriously at that deployment of money, because that leaves very little money to deploy on the other measures, on the Tier 3, on Tier 4, on things like advice, training, support for farmers, on the other aspects around nature restoration, which sit in Tier 3, on the supply chain measures, such as processing and marketing grants and all those other things. The more money is left locked up in direct payments under the current system, where most of that money goes to the larger farmers and is paid out on a per hectare basis, then you're going to run into real problems about delivery. So I don't see the budget increasing, particularly in the longer term. So how that money works is going to be a really important factor. It's going to have to work really hard. And I think that's where we would see some differences about how you spend that money, perhaps compared to some other members on the board.
Is this supplementary on Vicky's response?
Does Areob have a strategy in place to mitigate threats to food security in that case?
So Areob hasn't specifically discussed food security as an issue yet. I guess it depends what you mean, Rachel, by food security. If we take it in its broader sense, it's not just about how much food we produce. It's a wide range of factors. It includes thinking about poverty and whether people can afford to buy nutritious food and have access to it, as well as the quantum of food that we produce and also how we produce it, whether that's sustainable or not. So if you're talking about whether some of these policy decisions would have impacts on overall food production in Scotland, yes, they could. The extent to which that feeds into food security and becomes a problem, I think, is a whole other conversation that we could probably spend another committee session talking about.
I'm going to bring in Tim briefly and then move on to another question from Ariane Burgess.
It was just a very quick response to your
question there, Rachel. So as Vicky says, no, it doesn't directly. I mean, from my point of view, we've been involved. My organisation that's owned by sort of 60 farmer co-ops in Scotland, SEOS, we part of the government's food security task force that reported in June, and one of the key actions off the back of that was a food security unit. So that process is in motion, and that will sit within the Agricultural and Rural Economy Directorate. So in that respect, that agriculture and food security will sit side by side within the directorate, which wouldn't have happened until more recent times, albeit that's very early work in progress. So there's indirect input, but not directly. But opportunity to build on that, really.
Thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. So continuing on, so it's been really helpful to hear about your discussions around the design of future agricultural policy, and you've covered quite a lot of what I wanted to ask, but I just wanted to go a little bit deeper. The papers for today highlighted that AREOB has been considering definitions of regenerative and agroecology. And I'll just say, I'm going to direct this question to Vicky and then Anne, and then if anyone else wants to come in. I'd be interested to hear if you think including definitions of these terms or a list of principles are needed for the bill or somewhere in order to help farmers understand that direction of travel. And I'd also appreciate hearing your thoughts on the presentation that AREOB received from Climate Exchange on their study on the potential for an agroecological approach in Scotland.
Thanks very much, Ariane. Yes, I mean, there's been some discussion in AREOB around some of these terms, although, again, perhaps not extensively in terms of, I think we all recognise that the term regenerative is used somewhat loosely with different interpretations by people. Agroecology, I can't think of it off the top of my head, but there is a more defined terminology for what we mean by agroecology, but even within that, it can mean quite a different types of farming systems, including organic, but not exclusively, but tends to mean more about farming with nature and for climate. But I think it would be helpful to articulate better, both in terms of the policy and in terms of perhaps some principles for the bill, as you suggest, exactly what is meant. So it's referred to in the high-level vision that the Scottish Government put out, and it refers to things like nature restoration and climate mitigation and adaptation. But if we could drill down and agree some principles as to what we mean in a Scottish context, I think that would be very helpful. And I think the bill itself, if it has a clear purpose and principles at the start of it, that would very much help determine what then flows throughout the rest of that bill.
And just, I had another question, which was about the Climate Exchange study. I think you had a presentation from Climate Exchange. Oh, maybe you weren't there, because you're not an AREOB, right?
Yes, okay. So I don't know whether the members want to comment.
Went on that.
I mean, yeah, I can. The first question as well, but just this Climate Exchange. Okay, so in terms of regenerative, the terminology around these is very difficult to define. Many people would say regenerative farming is good practice, and you know, you mentioned what was mentioned by Andrew Moyer, you heard from last week, in terms of his farm, fairly large farm, but in terms of being regenerative, his carbon stocks have risen over the last 50 years. So this is about regenerative, to my mind, is actually putting back into the farm, into the land, into our biggest carbon sink, is what we've done, and doing it in a manner that's very very much in line with enhancing biodiversity as well. And in terms of woodland that's on Andrew's farm as well, I think it's to be commended. But I think that's a classic example of where we are. And it's not just about the big farms. Quite often the big farms play an awful lot in terms of emissions reduction, because they have the technology that's involved to reduce emissions, be more accurate when it comes to applications as well. In terms of the Climate Exchange, I think it's very very often we get strong views from Climate Exchange Committee, and I think, to be honest, quite frustrating. And I suppose I'm from my own perspective here now, I always find it very frustrating when we do hear comments that comes from, particularly against the beef side. It's quite frustrating because the beef are getting a real kick in just now, because methane's so bad, and it is bad, there's no doubt about that, but methane's about, you know, 25 times worse than what carbon is, a carbon equivalent. However, methane does break down to carbon and water, sequestered back into the soil that's been through green pastures, that's been grazed. raised, and that's why livestock is so important. And we've seen, you know, we've got to have this from a science base as well. We'll have to look at the science. And obviously, recently, we've seen James Hutton, fantastic research organisation we're all proud of in Scotland, and James Hutton were out, and this is very much linked to regenerative. So James Hutton Institute were in Macedonia last year looking at where they can help areas of ground that are struggling to grow beans, peas, pulses, any other leguminous plants that are helpful to the soil. And they discovered there that they couldn't actually plant much at all because they got rid of livestock a number of years ago, and the carbon assessment is now only sitting at half a percent. So they've discovered now, although they felt they couldn't afford to keep livestock, they now can't afford not to have livestock, because that was what was helping the soil carbon with the ability to then grow crops later on further down the line. So this is James Hutton Institute. This is not myself. This is James Hutton. You look at Rothamsted in Hertfordshire on the 23rd of December. They put out their most recent report. And given the scientific facts on this, they've got data going back to 1850, which is absolutely incredible. That's what kicked off the Rothamsted Research Institute in Hertfordshire. And they've discovered now, in terms of methane emissions, in terms of emissions reduction, methane's bad, but nitrous oxide is 300 times worse than what carbon is. But however, Rothamsted have discovered now that the importance of livestock in terms of farmyard manure and the effect that has on the soil structure and the influence that has on aerobic metabolisation of nitrous oxide is massive. So the difference that makes in arable soils, if you've got farmyard manure involved, it makes a huge difference. So that reduces the nitrous oxide emissions, which is the biggest issue around emissions from agriculture.
Thanks, Martin. We're going to move to Anne and then Kate, and then we're going to move on to the next question.
Thank you. So going back to your question on definitions, I would agree with Vicky. I think it would be hugely helpful to have more of a definition within the documentation, albeit that, you know, it needs to be flexible enough and adaptable enough to cope with the varying situations and different types of agriculture there is out there. Also in terms of economics, which must be key to underpinning all of this, along with the carbon and the biodiversity. It's vital that you know, the figures add up in terms of production and also in terms of costs, and that looking at the huge variability in terms of what we can grow and produce across Scotland is taken into account. On the climate, exchange, you know, it is very apparent that we need muck is a key component of that, as is grazing. The biodiversity, to get optimal biodiversity results, then that rarely means simply closing the gate. It's vital that we look right across the piece.
So I think it's quite important to make sure you understand that terms like regenerative agriculture and agroecology, first of all, are not understood by farmers on the ground at all, and can become somewhat divisive. They're not necessarily always seen as a positive thing by farmers because of, you know, for various reasons, but they need to be defined and they need to be properly explained to farmers. And I'm here as a member of IOB and representing Quality Meat Scotland, but I'm also a farmer. And I think it's really important to get across that every single farmer I know wants to improve their farm for future generations. You know, we are all, I'm a fifth generation farmer, we're all in this for the long term, you know, the whole long term, centuries. We don't want to be making things worse, absolutely. After my family, my farm is the thing that I love most in the entire world. And it's really, really important to me that it's left in a really good way for my children, if that's what they want to do. You know, I know where every bird's nest is, I know different trees, I know, I emotionally absolutely love the place and I want it to be left in as good a way as possible. And what we need to do is we need to help support farmers. Most farmers feel like that. We need to support them to do that. And part of that as well is to give more positive recognition and not just beat them on the heads for all the things that they are supposedly doing wrong, when all they've actually been doing over the generations is following policy signals. We need to be giving the right policy signals. We need to be giving them the right positive recognition for what they're doing, what they're already doing, what the potential that they could be doing. And we need to just get that message out right through industry and right through the whole of society that farmers are, you know, want to do the right thing and will do the right thing if they're supported in the right way to do it.
Thank you. Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, panel. And Kate, thank you for that last comment. Following on really from that, I represent Argyll and Bute, which has got a mixture of farming. One of the key things in farming, certainly on the islands and actually throughout Argyll and Bute, is the sustainability of population and how the investment, shall we say, which I think is the right term to use, it connects much more amongst the wider community. So, Martin, in your comments, you talked about LFAS. I wonder if you could expand a bit more on what you, what the Areo Board is advising with regards to LFAS payments. And I'd also... Sorry, I'm getting noises off from a sedentary position. And also about the views of how you've been looking at ensuring that population is sustainable across Scotland and actually the interconnectivity as well of farming from the West Coast to the East Coast. Big question. Martin, can you start?
Yeah, it is. It's a big question. In terms of the LFAS, Lisfield Area Support Scheme, so we have a subgroup set up within AREOB now looking at LFA support, where it should be positioned and the importance of it. So they haven't reported fully back yet, but you know, the understanding is, and to be honest, from right across the group, the understanding of how important LFAS is absolutely vital. For areas such as Argyll and Islands, it's absolutely vital. You know, all the islands, we really depend on that. We've talked about it as being a lifeline. It's absolutely a lifeline for these people because of depopulation. The social economic values that's brought off the back of that, when you look at what happens in our rural areas, it doesn't matter whether it's events or shows, but like agricultural shows, which tends to be the biggest event that happens in a local community, that's driven by, you know, active farmers that are on the ground. If it wasn't for active farmers and crofters, these shows simply would not happen. These are the things that are the sort of taken for granted elements that just always happens, but it doesn't happen itself. So that social economic values that is one of the, to my mind, is a classic public good. And a public benefit to what's been driven by investment in agriculture throughout Scotland, and we don't appreciate that enough. There's so many things within agriculture we have taken for granted for so long. You know, we have a fantastic tourism industry right now. The tourism industry are here because they want to see the fantastic mosaic patterns, they want to see active. They don't want to go into communities that's been absolutely depleted and deserted and left to go completely wild with no activity in it at all. That would be extremely frustrating. And in terms of the support interconnection, I think that's, we've obviously got serious issues from an island perspective at the minute as well, because obviously ferries does get raised, limited to what AREOB can do to sort the ferries, but the reality is that we've got issues there from a lot of our members that are concerned about that. But the connections between is vital, because this is about population, and if you don't have population, you don't have people living and working on the land, then you don't have that ability to try and have the people on the land that can build an environment and build on biodiversity as well. I'm proud of what we've got at home as well. I'm again small family farm, but where we are at home, we're delighted with the biodiversity we have. Some would argue it could be greater, but for an example, last Sunday we were when I was feeding sheep, I was at home, very rare occasion, and it was great to see that the lapwings were all back, and they were there for two reasons and two reasons alone, because we've got good grazing management and we've got predators that are under control. That's why they're there, and quite often that's overlooked. But again, this is what happens in rural areas. We're doing our absolute utmost, because as Kate said earlier, you know, family always comes first, but second is what you're doing in the farm. You want to put back into that ground what you've taken out of. There was a third part of the question. Sorry, Jenny. Was it interconnection and the Belfast, and there was another bit?
Yeah, the connections between East and West, the interconnections there.
Yeah,
as well.
So in terms of that, because, I mean, and we see that in some areas already that's happening. You mean between farms? So we've not looked at that specifically within Areob. That sometimes happens within the industry anyway, because we do see livestock move, in particular because we do see arable farms that will maybe winter cattle on the East, and they get the benefit of the dung. And sort of, you know, mentioned the muck is so important, putting that back onto the soil, that does actually work and it helps. So it's something that should probably be more encouraged, and again, through from a sort of, maybe it's something we could look at cooperatively as well, I don't know, but it does actually happen in practice. And we see that within regions, not just from east to west as well, but it's something that could be enhanced greater. Yeah, no, west, yeah.
Yeah. Very, very, very briefly, excuse me.
Okay, thanks, Convener. I'll try to be quick. I think if we get this right, there's huge opportunity for farmers, for communities in the rural economy. I think one thing to look at is how that investment is currently deployed. So the Highlands and Islands represent 50% of Scotland's agricultural area, but they currently get 16% of what's called the Pillar 1 money. They do slightly better out of the rural development support, get about 38%. So they actually get a really bad deal out of the current way the system works. So there is actually opportunity to change that in future. Even within LFAS, which is seen as effectively a farm income support, most of the money goes to the better quality land within the LFA. And not to the poorer quality land, the more marginal areas, which arguably need the greater levels of support to underpin the agricultural activity. So there's some fundamental flaws in the current policy, and in those less favoured areas, we need to stop thinking about them as agriculturally disadvantaged. We need to think about them as environmentally advantaged. They are the areas that can do a huge amount for delivering for nature and climate. We think of them as high nature value farming and crofting areas. They've got a huge amount to deliver. They do have a lot of the peatland resource, and I know you've had conversations about this. There's a massive job to be done there to restore degraded peatland, but I actually think there are jobs and opportunities in that for people in those places. So we don't necessarily need to look at some of these changes as negative. There's actually a lot of opportunity for very many businesses in this.
Sir Alan.
Thank you, Convener. You mentioned, as a panel, some of the consensus that exists and some of the variety of views that there are. I just wonder what the obstacles are that you would identify. This is a question for anyone who wants to come in. Perhaps obstacles on which there is a consensus. What are the obstacles in the way of reaching a conclusion?
Anne, would you like to tackle
that? I only ask this because you've mentioned progress is perhaps slower than you want. So what's the stumbling blocks? What's the challenges?
I suppose one of the biggest and most obvious stumbling block is how much money is going to be available at the end of the day, because as has already been mentioned, there's a huge amount that this bill is being expected to do. If the budget is sweeties, then that is what the outcome is going to be. So it's absolutely critical that is pitched at a level that is meaningful, that can deliver in terms of stability of food supply, making our agricultural industry resilient and also vibrant in order to attract new young people, so that it can then deliver on all the biodiversity, the climate change, the socio-economic aspects, which we've also covered, particularly in areas like Highlands and Islands, and further downstream industries, the shops, the businesses, the downstream services of markets, etc.
I think, Alistair, to come back to my earlier point, I think in general there's not
we're not sitting there loggerheads around the Ariob table kind of arguing back and forward in terms of the toss around different things. I mean, you know, as Anne said earlier, and Kate likewise, you know, we are there to give oversight in terms of what is presented to us. So a lot of where we've been at has been around process. And because the need to get a new agricultural bill drafted and into consultation has been, I think, the vast bulk of the resource taken up by officials within in the department. So that has you know, weighed on their minds, and that has certainly affected to some degree in terms of the pace we've been able to go at. We're there now. You know, that's now going under scrutiny, and I think it's really just a case about getting the pace of material pulled together, having a structured framework put in place in terms of how we meet, what the topics are, and I suppose come back to Jim's point earlier around what the focus is and what the prioritisation was in there. So, yeah, we're not. That's the good thing, I think. At the end of the day, there's not obstacles about decision making. I think we're actually all eager to get on and get going quicker on a lot more things.
Vicky and then Martin.
Yeah, I'd like to pick up on a couple of things my colleagues have said there. So I totally agree the funding question is a really big one, because we know that the scale of need to deliver against all these objectives is huge. So just to deliver the environmental land management, never mind everything else and the broader supports for the industry, one assessment recently, it's more than the existing budget alone. So if we add everything else in terms of rural development and food processing and advice and support and everything, potentially we're looking at a budget of £1 billion annually, which, you know, is probably not going to be on the table. The other big question is that there's actually only commitment to funding from the UK Treasury to 2024, and we have no idea what happens after that point. So the case has to be made for that ongoing funding. But in terms of the issues, I agree totally with Tim. There isn't disagreement, but I think there is a consensus that some of these things are difficult. When you look at Tier 2, which is going to have to deliver a lot, how you come up with something that's environmentally effective, that's practical for farmers to operate, and which government can actually deliver and monitor and report against to the Audit Office, Audit Scotland, who will be looking at and scrutinising this, is a really difficult job. And we are grappling with that and having conversations with government about how you do that and do it in the most effective way. But it's not easy.
Just before we come to Martin, can I ask, so you say there's no conflict, so is there compromise? Because I'm quite sure Vicky will have a different opinion on capping than Martin does, and I'm quite sure Vicky will have a different opinion from maybe Tim on genetic editing or whatever. So when you respond, can you bear that in mind? You know, we're talking about pots of money, Martin.
Yeah. So going back to the question from Alistair, where have we had obstacles and we've overcome the obstacles to get consensus? Probably the tiered structure is one of them. So coming to an agreement that the tiered structure is, you know, because we've always felt agricultural support, you know, we need that direct support, but we need to come to a way of trying to meet our objectives in climate and biodiversity as well. So the tiered structure that we've all come to a consensus is. Now, actually, Scottish Government have still got to, they're the ones that have been highlighted already, we're advising that's the way forward. So we're advising through consensus that's the way forward. We feel that probably is the right way forward, and that's part of that consensus. You're right on the capping issue. There is disagreements there, I would suggest, because you know, I would feel, and other colleagues would feel, that the capping process could be done a lot smarter in terms of we could be doing front-loading to help the smaller units, because when in terms of economy of scale, you've got small units that maybe have, for example, 25, maybe 30 cows. They've got a tractor and a loader. You've got another bigger farm, 140, 200 cows. They've also got a tractor and a loader, but the cost for that maintenance of that piece of equipment is far greater per cow. So front loading, which has been adopted before in the past, is something we would feel is a far smarter way of capping, because we could actually ask some of the bigger farms to do an awful lot more. And some of them are already doing that, and it comes back to, again, the recognition that they're not maybe getting for what they're already doing. And I'm afraid I'm going to bring it right back to the, we need to get this right in terms of our ability to still produce that quantity of food production as well. Because if we don't, it's not just us that's at risk. There's a huge economic risk here if we don't get this right. We've seen likes of Saltcoats, Dumbia down in Saltcoats have just invested £12 million in updating their abattoir to get it right up to spec in terms of animal welfare for output. They're relying on 1,000 farmers to produce high quality beef to keep that unit viable. There's 380 jobs there. 80% of them come from the local area. Fantastic, because they've got a butcher's academy delivering that. A great system. If that drops to 750 farmers because they can't afford to keep beef on the ground, does that then implode then the economic impact that has, the whole infrastructure around that area? And that's one very, very small example of what could happen right across the country if we don't get this right in terms of critical mass. And that's not just about beef. It's about fruit and veg. It's about right across the whole array of products that we are producing extremely well in Scotland.
We've got a follow-up from Alison, then a supplement from Ariane.
Yeah, just when you mentioned earlier on, or one of you mentioned earlier on about the opportunity to do things anew, but there is a tension, is there not? You've mentioned the challenges of trying to second guess what the UK will commit themselves to in terms of budget in the longer term. Are there other things about that wider UK context that present, let's just say, challenges, given that we've got UKEMA that this committee has been looking at and the Subsidy Control Bill and various other things? How do you fit what you're doing into that wider picture?
So absolutely has a huge bearing, because of the Internal Market Act as well, because that's very relevant to what's going to happen. You mentioned gene editing as well. You know, if we're going to use that in crops in south of the border, can we then use that in products or feed stuff up here or going into malt and barley in Scotland? That could be an issue. The Internal Market Act is extremely important in this, because we need to have some sort of broad speaking framework between, so we're all working from the same page to a similar degree. The outcome could be exactly the same. In fact, we believe that we could achieve that outcome far better because we're seeing a policy difference here than what's south of the border, because south of the border we are seeing, and that is evidence, we're seeing a reaction in terms of people just backing off and just farming to the ditch or farming to the fence side because they're not seeing. Now, there's going to be concerns about that. So I think we've got to take that in mind. In terms of UK influence and where the budget is going to be, and 100% agree with Vicky here and others, that budget is so crucial, and that we're only guaranteed that to the end of 2024 or indeed the end of the Parliament. We need to see that multi-annual framework coming back into agriculture. Tim's already alluded really well in terms of whether it's livestock breeding programmes or whether it's crop rotations. You're looking 5-6 years ahead. That's what agriculture is all about. It's not a short-time industry. We've got to look to the future, and five years just goes in a blink of an eye. So that more of a multi-annual financial framework that was delivered by Europe, and we got used to that for a number of years over a 7-year period. You knew what was going to be there. That's not there at the present time, and that's really, really concerning.
I'm going to take the next supplementary from Ariane, but I realise you want to come in on this, Tim, but we'll take the supplementary first.
Actually, Convener, I was going to ask questions around the subsidy control and UKEMA, so you've started to cover that already.
Rachel Hamilton.
It's a supplemental on this particular point about divergence. Does AREOB have a role in discussing divergence from EU alignment within the future of replacing CAP, particularly on the benefits to environment and health? For example, Martin mentioned gene editing. Is this something that you discuss as a group?
It's not something really that we've touched on yet. There's been so many other things to consider. It is obviously very important and something that does need to be taken into account, but we haven't done any more than mention it. And I think it's worth saying, going back to the previous point, that in Scotland we're doing this for the first time, and I think we need to recognise that the officials are working really hard and are probably overstretched and are having to do an awful lot. And you seem to be looking for a lot of conflict within AREOB, and that's what's stopping things. It's not. It's just been the actual capacity for the officials to move forward and to get things organised that has probably slowed it down more than anything, I would say. Thanks.
Bring Tim in, and then we'll move on to the next topic.
Yeah, all I was going to make the point was around the Alice's question about the funding, UK funding. Now, I mean, clearly that's a critical area we don't have visibility on that is of ultra-critical importance to our sector. But, at some point, agriculture has devolved to the Scottish Government. As Martin said, it represents little more than half a penny of every pound of monies that this Parliament decides how to spend. So, at some point, a decision's going to have to be made. We can't necessarily wait until what comes out of Westminster. Now, if, on light of some of the stuff we've talked about already, if we ended up repitching the sort of the farming sector as the sort of the National Food and Countryside Service, then perhaps that'd be easier for the Scottish Government to actually say, well, we will commit to the existing budgets over the next 5 years. Because that is the reality. We are providing the food. We are maintaining the countryside. We are linking up the West and East, coming back to Jenny's point. And that is going to be a massive issue, or is a massive issue in terms of signalling, in terms of what new policy looks like. And as participants last week were talking about, Jim Walker was talking about last week's session, cows are getting put off here and out there and everywhere because they don't know where things are going. And if ultimately we can come up with officials, with the government through AREOB in terms of more flesh on the tiered structure. But if ultimately all we're saying is you're going to get X, or you're going to get Y, or you're going to get Z, but we don't actually know what X, Y, and Z are, and they're not going to know that for another 2 years, then how many other thousands of cows are going to be put off, sheep are going to be put off, shepherds are going to be put off, areas put, fragile. So at some point, decision day is going to have to be taken, whether there's that exact clarity from Westminster. And it's all about decisions and choices.
Hey, thanks. Now move on. Slightly different topic with Karen Adam.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, and thank you for your testimony so far. It's been really enlightening. And something I'm quite curious to understand is, in regards to expectations, what are your expectations from the Agricultural Bill, and have they changed from when you first came into this, and if so, in what way? And I start with Vicky, please.
Thanks, Karen. I don't think they've changed. I mean, it's very clear that the Agriculture Bill, its purpose is to create the powers for Scottish Government to be able to deliver its agriculture policy and the payments that are attached to that in very simple terms. And that remains the case, I think, in terms of our expectations. That bill will also determine, as I understand it, how the forestry grants are spent. So I think Tim's right to talk about this is actually more than just agriculture. We are actually talking about some broader aspects of land use here in terms of what the powers will be created for. But I think it's clear that it has a really important role to, as we started off saying, to make sure that how we see agriculture and how we see land use in Scotland will be able to deliver sustainable food supplies in a way that is positive for nature and gets us to net zero. And that is at the heart of what this bill has got to try to do. But of course, all the detail won't be in this bill as we understand it. It's a framework bill. It will be quite high level. There will be a lot of secondary legislation that will have to come, which will obviously inevitably get less scrutiny because each scheme that is required, each payment, will have a whole set of secondary legislation related to it that will set out the exact criteria and how the schemes are going to operate. And all of that is yet to come and will be several years down the line, I think.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, in terms of the expectations, have they changed? I don't believe they have. No, I agree with Vicky. The expectations coming into this was about trying to have the advice Scottish Government to make the right decisions in delivering on food, climate and biodiversity. So, I mean, to be honest, that's a short answer, but no, it hasn't changed. I think we're all aspiring to try and get this right for so many reasons, because we've got probably one of the best opportunities here to really put Scotland on the map. I mean, we're on the map already, but we've got a greater opportunity to go back to what Kate had mentioned earlier on. If we don't get the buy-in from farmers and crofters here, we'll lose the opportunity to take this forward. So that's why we need to, this reflects back to the just transition as well, because we need to do it in a manner that we don't see farmers and crofters falling off a cliff, because that's when you see that, again go back to the resilience of the industry, that they'll survive, but everything else round about it will completely fall apart. So in terms of the sort of that sort of resilience, you know, we've got a great opportunity here. So in terms of things changing, no, the aspiration is still to get this right for so many reasons. And I'm always the eternal optimist. Sometimes it's challenging sometimes, but I think we've got a right to be optimistic because we've got an opportunity to get this right for the industry and for the country to showcase us all.
Okay. And we've got Kate and then Tim.
Yeah, just to say, I agree with the comments and expectations. I don't think that's changed. Just to supplement what Martin said, the Agricultural Bill needs to have enough flexibility in it to allow changes so that we don't end up with those unintended consequences that I mentioned before. So there needs to be the flexibility in there so that as time goes on and things change, we can adapt, Scottish Government can adapt and change policy as necessary to get to hit the right targets on the right things. So that was just the point I wanted to make.
Tim?
Likewise, expectations haven't changed in terms of what's come out within the consultation paper. From my point of view, from our point of view, was encouraging because it's a chance to build on what we have now, but also look at doing things in a different way. The organisation I represent, we are owned by the agricultural sector. We're owned by 60 co-ops in Scotland, and there's the agricultural co-ops in all your constituencies. And certainly where we have provision within the new agricultural bill will be that, particularly when it comes down to tier three funding, will allow agricultural cooperatives to actually potentially secure funds. And, you know, of course I would say it, but, you know, agricultural cooperatives, I mean, they represent about a third of our agricultural turnover in Scotland, so we're not talking a sort of fringe element. It's kind of what I talk about, the sort of the engine room across all our sectors, from unsupported through to fully supported. But it provided really effective means of delivery. Because at the end of the day, whether you've got 50, or you've got 500, or you've got 2,000, or 200 growers and farmers and crofters within those groups, then they're all aligned to a common purpose now already, predominantly based around food production and marketing. But actually, there's lots of work they're now starting to do about an aligned approach to environment, aligned approach to sustainability, aligned approach to climate change. So that is a great positive coming forward in terms of the new agricultural policy. And clearly, what funding goes into Tier 3 will be critical to help that. But it's so far, so good.
I'm going to bring in Vicky and then Anne.
It was just a quick comeback in terms of the sort of content of the bill, in a sense. It's slightly broadening it out from our expectations, but I think we've touched on about definitions around regenerative agriculture, for example, agroecology. So I think we need a clear purpose in the bill. We need some clear statements and principles right up front about what the bill is trying to deliver. Martin's alluded to the need for a framework. We've left the common agricultural policy. We'd argue that we should be looking at the minimum a three-year, but probably at least a five-year framework. We'd argue that there should be a requirement for government to produce a strategic plan, which will be analogous to what's happening in Europe at the moment, setting out exactly what it proposes to do, its rationale for doing it, the schemes and measures within it, and that it should have to report back to Parliament on progress on delivering that strategic plan. And we'd obviously like to see some targets included in that as well, linking through to targets, the climate targets, the nature targets that will come in the Natural Environment Bill. We can think about food production, we can think about organic agriculture, we can think about targets for lots of different things, and those exist already in some other legislation, so it should certainly point to that. So there's some content for the bill there that I think is going to be absolutely essential.
Anne, and then we're going to move on to Rachel.
Yeah, just a very quick point really, because others have covered it, but in addition to delivering on the carbon and biodiversity fronts, it does need to be adaptable enough as farming itself is evolving all the time with increased technology and science, and to provide a sufficient bedrock for a viable industry so that industry is in a position to reinvest, to be innovative and to attract future generations. In terms of policy stability, I think that's really important because, as we've heard numerous times before, because of the length of time on life cycles or even sort of smaller issues like, you know, the lead-in time for buying a tractor these days is a year minimum. So just sort of fundamentals like that have to be taken into account. And of course, every time there's a change in or significant change in policy, not only does that impact on the ground and farmers and crofters having to get their head around that and understand what's required and change their farm policy, but also it has a big impact on the delivery. So for ARPID, for example, what impact does that have in terms of computers, in terms of cost of that, and also the general resourcing? So I think my plea would be that we have policy stability that allows outcomes to be actually delivered and an efficient use of resources from all fronts.
Yeah. Rachel.
Can I ask anyone from the panel what your assessment is of the uptake of the National Test Programme? Shall I start with you, Martin?
Yeah.
Sorry, that we're on to the next yeah. question. Sorry, Rachel.
Yes, on the National Test Programme.
Yeah, can I just, before we bring that to an end, can I just ask a question? Martin, we've talked about flexibility and adaptability, but we also need safeguards within the legislation. Can I ask you what you would want to see in the face of the bill that potentially safeguarded payments for Tier 1 or Tier 2 or some reassurance about conditionality going forward to bring more certainty rather than waiting for secondary legislation that there's going to be, as we've heard, there's not as much scrutiny. What would you expect to see in the front of
the bill? Well, in the face of the bill, I'd be desperate to see, you know, food production, sustainable food production on the face of the bill, and in terms of that baseline payments being highlighted, in terms of, from my perspective, and I'm sure others, the importance of seeing that 50% base payment and it achievable through management options within the Tier 2 payments, because the issue is, if we go down the route of having income forgone or additional cost, these options won't be taken up. If we take up these management options, we'll have a great opportunity here to get the buy-in from the industry. And this goes back to the point I made earlier. If we get this right and highlight that in the face of the bill, that then we get the buy-in from the industry, then we're on the right track. If we lose the industry right at the start, forget it. And I really mean that. We've got to get the industry, because we're the people that's going to have to deliver it. It's the farmers and crofters. We've got 1% of our population that are producing the food for us. We've got another 99% that seem to have a great idea how we can do it. And they've got some great ideas, and we need to take some of them on board. But the experts on actually how to do it are the ones that are on the ground doing it at the minute. So it's an agricultural bill. Make sure that we've got food production absolutely in the face of this bill.
Thank you. And now, Rachel, thank you.
Well, on that particular point, if you are listening to farmers, why are other groups such as FAST setting up?
Because I think there's other groups setting up because they want that related back to the industry is very, very keen to hear from from Scottish Government what's happening. And of course that delivery of what the outcomes is coming is not getting out yet. We're beginning to get that progress, but it is slow, and I said right at the start this is extremely slow. I'm involved in the FAST group as well. We're all, you know, it's the FAST group is just, we've got there's butchers in there, there's craft butchers in the FAST group, so that's the whole wider group that just want to hear what's happening. That's why that group is set up, because it highlights exactly what I talked about earlier on, because if we don't get this right, the critical mass aspect for everybody else that's relying on that is incredible. So that does involve the likes of our butchers, our processors that are keen to see what's happening.
Just before we move on, Vicky's got a comment on that.
Sorry, I was going to answer the question in terms of the National Test Programme. But also, I mean, I can pick up on that. I mean, I think you've been searching for some contention to some extent. I mean, you're asking, just coming back to the point about on the face of the bill. I mean, I think there are issues around, as I said before, if we continue to fix 2/3 of the budget in direct payments, then we are limiting what's available for everything else that has to deliver. And those direct payments are not working in terms of delivering against all the objectives and all the outcomes that we're trying to achieve, and that is problematic. So if we fix in the bill that 50% will remain in the base payment and 50% of those direct payments will be in Tier 2, personally, to coin a phrase, I don't think government's got a cat in hell's chance of meeting its objectives in terms of agriculture going forward, under the current way those payments are deployed. And that's why I think we are looking at transforming. We absolutely need to transform our farming policy and our farming and food systems to deliver against those outcomes. So there's some really difficult choices to be made there. In terms of the test programme, I mean, I think it's...
You suggest we're looking for contentious areas. Absolutely. Because I want to know how the AREOB actually then reports or makes recommendations, and that is absolutely critical. You know, you said you come to a consensual agreement. There's no consensus over capping. There's no consensus over Tier 1, Tier 2 payments. How do you move forward? What is your role, Martin, as the chair or the co-chair, in advising the government on that? So, yeah, you're absolutely right. I'm looking for contentious areas and finding out how we actually resolve those.
Yeah, well, that's, I mean, you know, we're there to obviously advise Scottish Government. There's views taken, there's broad views taken right across the board here. And you've just highlighted, and Vicky's highlighted, where that contentious issues are going to be. Because, again, it comes back to if we see there's not a, you know, not a cat and health chance of reaching some of the targets in climate and biodiversity. My argument from that and others would be, if we want people to buy into this, unless we do this correctly, then so in terms of... Because we then lose the industry. It's not just agriculture that's at stake here. This is about the Scottish economy that's driven on the back of food production and marketing and processing. That's what, you know, without that in Scotland, food and drink is our biggest economic driver. We cannot forget that. If we lose that opportunity...
But you've put that on record already.
All right,
I suppose
sorry.
The specific question is, are you making compromises on the behalf of farmers... No. To then speak with a single voice.
Hands up here, and probably as co-chair, and I have been challenged on this, and I'll be absolutely honest, I've been challenged on this as co-chair. I should be taking the consensus and not putting forward my personal or the industry's views. I would be failing in my job as NFU Scotland President if I did not put forward where the industry, I think, the direction of travel should be going. If that was the case, then, quite frankly, I would probably not be so keen to carry on, because I am elected as President of NFU Scotland. I'm on this group as AREOB, as co-chair, and I accept the fact, and I have been challenged on that, but I accept the fact that I've got to try and come to that consensus with the Cabinet Secretary. That sometimes is difficult. But we've got to try and get there, but I would be failing in my job if I didn't take forward the views of where I think the industry stands right now.
That's helpful. Tim, briefly, and then bring Rachel back
in. I think it's the stage of the process we're in. So to use the analogy, you know, we know we need to build a house. You know, we've agreed on the aspect, we've dug the trenches, the founds are in, which we can all broadly agree on. But, you know, we're only at the point now where the walls and the roof are going on, but we haven't just, you know, what the plan of the house looks like inside is yet to be agreed. And that contention will happen, but we've not come to that stage because we've been slow getting to this point.
Rachel.
Tim, I would dispute that the foundations are in place. I would like to ask you what your assessment is of the uptake and progress of the National Test Programme.
It's disappointing. Why do I think it's disappointing? Would be the next question, I imagine. So I suppose from my perspective, I think it's because whilst we can see that it is the early foundation stones of what a future policy might look like, the rest of that signalling, the rest of the potential flesh on the bone and the skeletons around it is not clear. So they're a bit, they're sitting there a little bit off left field. They're sitting a little bit disjointed because farmers, crofters at large, can't actually see how it all fits in the big picture. And so I think that's on one hand. I think secondly, there's an element for some of it, and certainly I know this from we have small farm, live in a rural community, have farming friends and everything else, and some are sitting back waiting because there's a slight fear that if they're not already doing a carbon footprint audit, which a number of folk have been, as you heard last week. But I don't know if we'll start on this journey, because I'm not quite sure, will this help me or will this hinder me down the road? So actually the easiest thing is to sit back a little bit and see where we get to. So that's kind of my assessment, Rachel.
Where does that responsibility sit, that the farmers don't know what the national test programmes supposed to deliver? Is that you guys, or is it the government, or is it?
It'd be within the wider communications that come out from government, which there has been sort of increased efforts around. I mean, originally it was pretty hidden, I would say, how it all fits together. I would hope that's starting to change, but you know, the first year claim period is now past. So
I've got Vicky and then Kate.
Yeah, so I think it's important to remember there's two parts to the National Test Programme. There's the preparing for sustainable farming and testing for sustainable farming. So preparing for sustainable farming is where the money's on the table already for doing things like soil testing, carbon audits. The Animal Health Plan this year has been brought in, and Nature Scot are looking at if a simple biodiversity audit could be introduced. We're talking about 23. We've yet to see whether that's possible or not. We really hope it will be. Obviously, the take-up hasn't been sufficient of that. I think farmers are watching, waiting. There's been communication probably problems, and it hasn't got out there as much. There has been this second part, which is testing, which is difficult because we don't quite know what we're testing yet because we haven't developed all that detail. But they have gone out and done surveys with farmers. The plan is to try to get a cohort of farmers to work with government to look at what could be some of the measures introduced to think around Tier 2 and how that could work in practice. I think they need to put more money into that. They need to develop it, to grow it, to get a serious cohort, a representative sample of farms and crofts across Scotland, work with farmers to work out what would work practically on the ground, but also deliver against the objectives, and really use that to inform the thinking of the policy development as it goes forward. The challenge, of course, is where does the money come from that? Because we've had a pot of money set aside to do that national test programme, but meanwhile, of course, all the other payments have to continue under the current legislation. So actually, it's quite difficult to find significant sums of money to do a lot of that work. There is a pot of money there. There could be more if government made those choices to invest more in that side of things.
Rach, can I just bring in Kate, and then you can come back in?
Yeah, sure. It was on Vicky's point, but yeah.
All right.
Yeah, just to agree with him, I think the problem is that farmers do not see this bigger picture, and that is absolutely down to communications, and I would say Scottish Government communications, because they are the ones that have to communicate this. So I don't think farmers do understand how everything fits together in the way that we are privileged enough to do, and I think there has been an issue with getting that out there, and that is partly why the FAST group has been set up, because there were other parts of industry who were hearing literally nothing at all. And I absolutely understand there's a balance between putting out lots of incomplete information, which is just going to cause confusion, as Anne alluded to. You know, you have to get your head around policy, or not putting out anything. And I think the balance was the wrong way to begin with. I think that is improving. And the FAST group has been a way of the whole sector just sort of coming together to try and get that information out. And I think it also needs mentioning that there are, I think, as far as I know, there have been delivery issues. There isn't the capacity in a lot of the advisory services, a lot of the testing services, to do all this work in a big mass all at once. So that's also an issue, and something else that we have flagged up at Arioub, along with the improving communications need.
Yeah, I mean, I feel in my own head that I'm getting conflicted messages here from last week's panel to this week's panel, because on one hand, Arioub is saying that there's not the capacity in their agricultural advisers, and then on the other panel, you know, we had Jim Walker saying that he can only describe the net zero measures as embarrassing because farmers are already carrying out these audits on their own backs. So if we want farmers to be successful and be part of meeting net zero targets, surely Arioub should be engaging with farmers to ensure that they are part of this, rather than creating a new middle group of people that are benefiting it, rather than bringing the economic benefit back into farmers that Vicky had described as perhaps being, not in these words, but there were some that were leading the majority of leading the way, but most of the farmers were not carrying this out. So I'm really frustrated about this, because it seems as though farmers are the last in the group of getting benefit from this.
Can I come back? I mean, I think part of the problem is some of the farmers that were in the farmer-led groups and that you were talking to last week are probably some of the top-performing farmers. So there is a huge difference between the top-performing quartile in farmers and the bottom in terms of business efficiency and productivity and a whole load of different metrics. And probably the farmers in those farmer-led groups are at the forefront of the thinking of what the sector needs to do on multiple different fronts, and they are leading the way. But the reality is that there's an awful lot of farmers that are not in that position, and for various reasons, whether it's economics, whether it's a knowledge issue, whether it's an advisory issue, whatever, are not at that place. And so the job of policy and the job of some of this investment is to ensure that all those other farmers are up where those leading farmers are. And it's helping farmers understand that for many of the climate-related measures, for example, if we look at the marginal abatement cost curves, many of those things make good business sense for farmers to do already. They will actually improve the profitability of the farm and save money overall. But not all farmers know that, and not all farmers are practicing that. So whether it's through education and training and advice, whether it's through regulation, whether it's through incentive, a whole package of things are needed to get every farmer in Scotland to be where we need them to be, to manage their land, to deliver those outcomes that we're looking for.
Yes, I was just going to add to that there can also be differences by sector. A lot of the more intensive sectors, for example, pigs and poultry, and particularly dairy, have already been driven down the road of having to do certain audits, etc., by processors. So that all have made a key influence on how far they are down the road. And also, as Vicky said there, as we've touched on before, there is a massive range in terms of scale of farming business from the crofts, common grazings, to the bigger intensive units.
Jenny Minto.
Thanks, Convener.
Martin, beg your pardon.
Yeah, it was just really on the uptake on the preparing for sustainable farming. I think there'll be a far bigger uptake this coming year, is my view. That's what I'm getting from the soil testing company that we use. And I was number, back in January, I was number 389 that had applied for the soil testing part of it. You know, we've done our carbon audits, but that was because we've been involved in the beef efficiency scheme, and we've continued to do that. But I think the communication has been highlighted already. It was actually poor at the start. I think it is getting better, but that uptake needs to be a lot stronger, because if we don't do that, then other countries are going to take the lead. We've got a lot of farmers doing it on a regular basis, but that uptake I see will increase. My view, my personal view is, and this is coming from the soil companies, is there's a lot of people now switched on to this happening, and this year is the year that the uptake will be far greater, and I hope that happens. And we'll be doing our part to try and put that message out, but this is a communication issue that's got to come from Scottish Government. It could be easily done through forms that have got to be done on the face of the forms that have got to be done in May, so that they've got the opportunity to take that up, because it's a necessity, as far as I'm concerned, to do these audits, because if we don't do them, then we'll have other countries that will take that lead, and then we need that reinforcement to show where Scotland is, because if we're doing that, particularly with the carbon assessment we're now getting in our soils, it'll highlight where we are in Scotland in global terms, and that'll make a big difference when it comes to trading our products.
Yeah, Tim, you wanted to add a comment? Yeah.
Rachel, I suppose it was by way of reassurance in terms of sort of one area of work that's been undertaken, quite a lot of it below the radar, but which is to the wider benefit of the entire Scottish cattle sector, has been, actually it was a follow-on from what Jim Walker was bracing a little bit last week around data, and saying there's a lot of industry-related data that's held within the Scott EID service in Huntly, which we oversee. That data has actually all now been mined effectively, and dashboards are now available to every single cattle keeper in Scotland, utilising their data that they've put on in terms of registering the birth of animals, in terms of the death of animals, and etc., which is called My Herd Stats. And that is actually now being presented back into a performance dashboard that every producer can see, see how efficient their carving is, how their mortality rates are. You link that up with other parts of the supply chain. It's all around improving productivity. So that is free to use, and that is all off the back of data there originally. And I think that's a key point in terms of saying, well, there's a start, but how much more can we do that doesn't, one, create a lot of bureaucratic burden, but actually provides opportunities for farmers going forward to make decisions built around and data. So that is now launched. Everyone's got that available.
We're actually going to move on to that in our final question, but just to close off the national testing framework, Jenny Minto's got a supplementary.
Thanks, Convener. I think it falls into this topic of conversation. I was interested in views on the monitor farms and how that is feeding into the area process. And also, if I should have asked the last time as well, tenant farmers, what work have you been doing to ensure that they're included in the way forward too?
The monitor farms one, yes. Obviously, the monitor farm programme has just started again, the next iteration of it. We've had the first meetings for all the 9 farms, and the idea for it is very much as a platform to get all this sort of information out, working with the monitor farmers themselves to see what changes they want to make, and then cascading that out to the wider community. And it does absolutely work. I'm a past monitor farmer myself. I know how some of the things that we did 10 years ago have cascaded out. So it does work, but it needs to be ramped up. And we're definitely, there's much more of a focus on business efficiency and on sustainability right through the whole programme. And there's much more collaboration between the 9 monitor farms. So they're not as much in isolation as they were in previous programmes. On the tenant thing, I can assure you that's brought up regularly. Martin and I are both tenant farmers, specifically things like carbon credits and, you know, who gets them in that sort of tenant situation, planting trees, all that sort of thing. It's all brought up at Ariob. I would say probably more on the fringes, it's not specific topics, but always a consideration in whichever subject that we are looking at.
Thank you.
But just before we move on to our last, we've actually run out of time, but if nobody's rushing away, it would be good to get another 10 minutes or so on our final question. That would be helpful. And I'll move to Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Convener. Took me by surprise there. Yeah, there are key areas of uncertainty around future policy. And Tim, you just touched on data there. Where's the research gaps? And Martin, I noticed that you seem to be disagreeing with Vicky when she was talking about the LFA side of things. So what are the differences there in terms of what Ariob should be doing? And what areas of research are Ariob using to help to develop the policy? Martin, I'll start with you, given the fact that I've cited your LFA thing. Come to you after that, Vicky.
Okay, so in terms of the LFA, I mean, it comes back to the sort of contentions we're having there and trying to come to that consensus, which is going to be challenging. I mean, our view has always been that LFA is... I mean, our LFA farmers are 100% reliant on that support and where that's coming from and what it's delivering in the wider economic points that Jenny had mentioned earlier on. So,
do you have a specific research that you're looking at in terms of where the LFA should go? Is it based purely on rural depopulation, i.e. keeping farmers there, or and do you dispute science that perhaps Vicky would use?
I would dispute this, the science to a degree that Vicky's used, because in terms of the LFAs going to the better land all the time, it depends on per hectare basis that may be the case, but per business basis it's going to some of the biggest units that there is delivering an awful lot in terms of employment and biodiversity benefits as well. So I think if you look at it purely in a per hectare basis, because the LFA system is designed and set up to recognise where some parts of the sector, particularly the beef side, is really struggling. So there is a weighting towards that, depending on your stock and density. I'll not go into the details of it, but depending on the stock and density, that gives you an uplift if you're supporting beef production, which is extremely important in these areas. And without that, they simply would not be there. This is not a we can tweak it or what. If that support's not going into these areas, these people will not be there. So in terms of that real depopulation, that will happen. And I could practically guarantee that, because that is an issue. We'll lose the people. And they're the people that we can put. So in terms of how do we change that slightly, well, if we still had LFA support as a direct payment within Tier 1 and Tier 2, there could be conditions within that to say you are taking part in various options that is there under the enhanced payments in Tier 2. That wouldn't be an issue. If you're still partaking in your cabin audits and you're doing your soil testing, these baseline issues under Tier 2, if you do that, then you're eligible for your LFA payment. And that's putting conditions on it, but it's still being seen as a direct payment.
So I will come to you, Vicky, I promise you. I just want to explore this a wee second. If the LFA support is altered in a way that doesn't support producing calves, mm-hmm. those calves are then sold down to the lower down the country. That in itself is helping the carbon or the quality of the soil further down the country. So are you saying that it's not just about keeping people there, it builds into the whole thing? Yeah. Of how we maintain the carbon in all soils, not just in the hill soil.
It builds into the whole thing because traditionally the calves in the hills go down to the lower ground. The lower ground, if you take, for an example, my father-in-law in Fife fattens a few hundred cattle every year. Now, they're not his own cattle, he's a finisher. So this is why we've got to look at things on more of a circular basis. He's a finisher that buys calves from the upland areas, and he puts a lot of dung on his soil in Fife. His carbon assessment from an arable perspective as a very traditional farmer is very, very good in the soil, because they've been doing their carbon assessment in the soil. That's partly to do because the amount of dung that's gone back in the soils. So this is about, so it's not, we can't look at it in isolation, and we need to get away from this, because if we have an effect of reducing the numbers that's on the uplands, then the effect that has not only in the viability of our lowland producers that are finishing the cattle, because they can do it far more efficiently than what we're doing, but the effect we're also seeing now is we're losing that ability to actually keep our own infrastructure in place. We're seeing it already this year to a large extent. The huge number of cattle that's now going south of the border that will actually no longer get finished in Scotland, because it'll be a southern abattoir that's going to get the benefit of that because they're going to be finished down there. Why is that happening? Because there's less cattle south of the border now as well. So the impact that has is massive.
So we're looking at critical mass plus...
Absolutely, sorry. Plus, and the wider benefits of what...
I'm sorry, Martin, we're really short of time. Vicky?
Yeah, so I just want to be clear that I'm not arguing against money going into those hill and upland areas, Jim. In fact, I'm actually arguing that more money, that they get a really poor deal, actually, out of the current system, as I highlighted when I said that they're only getting 16% of Pillar 1 support, the basic payment and other schemes, and yet they're 50% of the area. I think we would approach it differently in terms of how you better support farming and crofting in those areas. We have ideas around a high nature value farming scheme or payment, which could be potentially either situated in Tier 2 or possibly in Tier 3.
Can I ask you, Vicky, and how does that feed into making sure there's a critical mass of numbers?
Because it's about supporting the high nature value farming systems and the livestock production that takes place there.
But if there isn't enough cattle on the ground in the first place, that system falls down. So how does the... I fully understand, I've grazed cattle on the hill, so I fully understand the position you're taking. But how does the not having enough numbers on the ground support the critical mass as well as doing the high nature value farming?
Well, I think you've got to look at the whole package of support that's potentially going into those areas across all the tiers and how you support the farming and crofting that's taking place there, which in turn retains that critical mass that you're talking about. Mm. Of course, it's as important for delivering for nature to have some of those livestock grazing in those places, to have the cropping and grazing systems on the Macca and in the Western Isles, for example. So you know, agriculture is going to continue. But what we're talking about actually is why we're losing critical mass from these places is because the current system does not support them very well. Now, there will also need to be some change, some land use change in some parts of Scotland. We need to think about that alongside agriculture. There is no pathway that will get us to net zero without transforming how we farm and produce food, without land use change, which will include some woodland expansion, without dietary change, and without reducing waste. That is just what the science tells us. There are different choices within the pathways we can choose, and we are doing some work as RSPBR conservation scientists at the moment, which is being peer-reviewed, looking at different pathways. You can just about get to net zero if you deploy every possible tool in the toolkit, but it means some really difficult choices about the future. And it does have some implications for livestock production in Scotland. That is just the reality. But I also wanted to say earlier that I really think there is some opportunity in here. You had a whole conversation about peatland restoration. We are crying out for people with skills, land management skills, who can use machinery to do peatland restoration. There are 1.4 million hectares of degraded peatland in Scotland, which in the inventory, land is an emitting sector. The sequestering effect of land, the trees and everything else, is not sufficient to counter the emissions from land, and particularly from peatland at the moment. Sorry, I'm going off, but it's really important that there's opportunity in that. In terms of, can I just say, sorry, convener, in terms
very,
of
very,
research,
very briefly.
Very briefly, the academic advisory panel is advising ARIOB. There's lots of research coming in. We need more research into agroecological farming methods because traditionally a lot of that has gone into the more traditional conventional farming sectors. James Hutton and SRUC are doing loads of stuff and we're drawing on all of that to inform our thinking.
Okay. Beatrice Wishart.
It's a brief question at the very end. If you have, if you've identified any data or research gaps in the course of your work, how are they being addressed or how might they be addressed?
All the time we're trying to identify data research, and what we did through the FLGs took on a lot of data from a whole range of academic advisors has given us data from, whether it's from SRUC, obviously from a hill farming point of view, is very important. James Hutton, we take these, you know, research institutes are hugely valuable to us, and if there's ever a gap at all, we will pull in professionals that actually understand fully the implications that we're trying to fill that knowledge gap. We do have that availability. One that we haven't probably covered is, and it probably links back to what Vicky had said, and it was on the terms of relevant to food production, is the diet issue. And it may be an opportunity for the RAIN committee to listen to Professor Alice Stanton in terms of what red meat actually does, because we do it so well here in Scotland and other areas, listening to some of that research. So I'm sorry, I know you're asking us where we get our data from, but if we identify a data gap, then we will fill it by the sort of professional research institutes that are looking, you know, that are involved in that. But as a suggestion from a dietary point of view, it would be a great opportunity for this committee to hear the reality of what red meat production actually provides.
Thank you.
Rachel Hamilton, briefly.
If 1% of land is producing our energy source of food, Vicky, how will all the solutions to meeting net zero within the sphere of this new replacement for cap system be realistic?
Sorry, Rachel, I'm not quite sure.
So
if what, so 1% of
so
land...
You were talking about the change of land use. I'll phrase it differently. What percentage of what you are doing, overseeing Scottish Government's work, will contribute to meeting net zero targets?
So agriculture and how we produce food and wider land use, particularly rural land use, has an enormous role to play in terms of sectors and the contribution to us getting to net zero, and of course not forgetting nature, because we face a nature and climate emergency. And I think the evidence from the Committee on Climate Change was from Chris Stark was very clear to you.
No, that, it wasn't. They were saying was that land that shouldn't be kept in full-time pasture was no longer sequestrating carbon and should go into trees. So I've never heard that before.
So I think what they're saying is that if you think in terms of grasslands and its carbon sequestration ability, permanent grassland and the longer it's been there, it reaches an equilibrium. So it's not constantly sequestering. So this is the issue. So in some cases, the alternative or other land uses, so planting trees, particularly broadleaf woodland, where we're planting for the very long term. So when you get into commercial forestry and you've got short rotations, then obviously you've got a different carbon cycle going on there compared to a broadleaf tree, which might be there for 200 or 300 years and which is locking up that carbon as it grows. So it is quite complicated, but I think what the committee were trying to say to you in the sense of agriculture and land use and the emissions from agriculture and from what's in the inventory under the land use change and forestry category has a really important role. And as other sectors reduce their emissions over time, transport, housing, and everything else, it shines the light on agriculture because we can't produce food without emissions. That's just the reality. We interact with the soil, livestock graze, cows burp, that's just the reality. So the sequestering effect of land is really important in thinking about the overall net position. But the problem with the wider land sector at the minute is that it is an emitting sector. So if you look at LULUCF in the inventory, it's showing it as a small, above the line, emitting greenhouse gases. But the reality is that you've got a lot of sequestering below the line, which is the trees soaking up carbon and peatland in good heart. But because we have so much degraded peatland in Scotland, 1.4 million hectares, it's a massive, in fact, it's the largest emitting sector of any sector. And until we bring that down...
I think we're maybe just problem. Getting into too much detail. I'm quite sure everybody else would want to give their opinion on this. So I think we're really short of time. Sorry, I'm going to stop you there. Jim, you're
Yeah, go for it. Thank you. And I'm going to make one comment. It's not a question, it's a comment. The thing that concerned me about the evidence we got last week from the CCC was the word probably. The word probably would reduce the amount of greenhouse gas that was being sequestered. But Martin, my question is for you. You have said in the past that 90%, 97% of the funding, if we're talking about uncertainty of future policy, 90% of the funding has come from the UK government. If that stops in 2024, or there is no certainty, where do you see us going there?
It's a massive... That's a massive risk. We cannot afford that to stop. If that stops, then our ability to produce and deliver the outcomes that we're all trying to achieve from a climate and biodiversity point of view completely disappears. So what will happen, and it relates directly to the last question, what will happen is we'll see particularly 85% of our area will just contract on what they're producing. That's exactly what will happen, and it relates directly, sorry Jim, if I can just say it relates directly to what will happen on the ground in terms of rank vegetation that's been highlighted already, because then we do get into the issue of around wildfires. And we just can't control them. And I'm not going into the details, but I've spoken to the fire service in this, who are extremely concerned about this in Scotland in terms of wildfires if we let rank vegetation go off, because we'll no longer be in a position of keeping it grazed and keeping it in a carbon sequestrating state. Okay. Very briefly on the building and equilibrium of that carbon, again, I'll come back to Rothamsted and speak to the scientists there that put that report out, Andrew Neil. If we build our soils, we can actually build the carbon. Yes, it can, because we have got depleted soils at the minute. But if we build our soils, we can add to the carbon. We can keep that. So we can actually do that. It's only saturated if our soil level stays the same.
OK. I would like this committee to invite the UK Government Minister to come and speak to that particular question. But do you, as an organisation, And I'm asking you, as the NFU now, given the fact that the AREOB won't be, are you speaking to the UK government about getting an assurance about those payments?
Absolutely. I was in London last week on that specific issue. So at every opportunity we are down making sure that we... Because this is so important, absolutely so important, because that funding of £637 million, relatively speaking, comes into the agriculture directly. Of that £637 million, £620 comes from Westminster. So that is absolutely vital that's continued, because this is about keeping, you know, the whole, our ability to deliver what the outcomes are going to achieve. And I'm, as I said, you know, I am optimistic. I think we have got a great opportunity to do it here, but we won't do it without the funding.
Okay, thank you, convener.
I'm going to ask, as the convener, the last question. It's quite a difficult question, but you'll be able to answer it fairly quickly. So, this is specifically for the members of AREOB. So you're all there representing a sector of some sort, but those sectors you represent already have lines of communication with the government. It's been suggested that the AREOB is actually just another layer, another way for the government to stop make decisions, and it's just another talking shop. And folk will justify it by saying, well, the arable sector is forging ahead, not waiting for AREOB to advise the government and the government to act. We had, again, Jim Walker talking about the Suckler Carbon Efficiency Programme, which was developed, funded, costed, but we've not seen anything move forward with that. But it's now been adopted in an island. So can you justify your position and not just being a talking shop, which is actually AREOB's the reason for the delay and slowness in production of policy, Martin?
Whatever happens, there will be a policy decision. Whatever happens, there will be an agricultural bill, and there will be outcomes in primary legislation delivering the flexibility on that. Secondary legislation will come behind it. So whatever happens, and we're getting to that process pretty quickly, yes, the industry is desperate to see that progress, but if we're not involved in that process now, then what's going to happen? So the reason I would suggest that we absolutely justify our involvement in this is to get the correct outcomes that's going to allow us to compete, to continue to produce the food that we take for granted and deliver the outcomes we're also trying to achieve.
This is specifically about AREOB, not so that,
well, so it's absolutely about AREOB, because, that's... You know, it's still a given. It's still a given, because we have to be involved in steering that direction of travel.
Thank you. Kate?
Yes, I mean, government have to make these decisions. They're going to be made. And quite frankly, the reason that I would imagine most of us agreed to sit on this was to make sure that we influenced that in the way that we, you know, we need it to go as an industry. I would totally contest anything about AREOB holding this back. I think, if anything, we've pushed this forward much quicker than it would have gone without us.
Okay. Anne?
I would totally agree with Kate's last point there. I think the AREOB has been at pains to speed up the process, and also to ensure that the realities and practicalities of how this policy can be delivered on the ground are heard front and centre.
Thank you. And finally, Tim.
Absolutely. And I mean, when we started off this AREOB process, then, you know, we were all very clear, or virtually all of us were very clear, that then there were three legs to a stool here. There was the climate emergency, there was nature restoration, and there was food production. And if food production was not the third leg of that stool, then many of us were not going to be involved. That is reflected within the vision there. It's reflected in with a lot more of the detail that's now coming through the route map and other parts around that. And it sounds a pretty basic thing to say, but we put that on record and got that agreed prior to the sad events in Ukraine, which has just got vindicated more than ever. So maybe a small couple of words, but that's absolutely critical, because we're not going to get the nature restoration and the climate change unless we actually have food producers actually buying into this.
Thank you very much. Really appreciate the additional 20 minutes, because I know you're all very, very busy people. It's been a really useful session. That concludes our meeting in public. We'll now move into private session, and I suspend the meeting for 10 minutes.